TV says, nice try. You've had a practice. But wait, start over. Good evening, everyone. It is now exactly 7 p.m., November 28, 2016. This is Owen Sound City Council. We're starting our meeting tonight. Right now, we have not been in a closed session before. So I'm starting off with number two, if there's any declaration. Nope, that's moving into the regular meeting. Additional items. Any additional items, staff?
Your Worship, I have one item relative to the wastewater treatment plant.
Thank you. Going to staff first. Mr. Alan Parker?
Sir, I have two. One about the streaming council and one about...
Any other staff? Seeing none. Okay, now council. Looks like everybody. Might as well start in one end. Councilor Lemon?
Yes, having to do with my job.
Thank you. Councilor Koepke.
Thank you, Your Worship. One item on the YMCA Peace Medallion, one on the Mill Dam update, and one on Giving Tuesday.
Councilor O'Leary, do you have anything?
Thank you, Your Worship. I have three Festival of Northern Lights for the Birthday Wish and a comment on OPP Costing Committee.
So that's two?
Three.
Three, okay. Deputy Mayor Wright.
Thank you. Just one item on Georgian College.
This way, Councilor Thomas.
Mr. Worship, I have an item on the library negotiations and a second item on county support for a moratorium on school closures.
Thank you. Councilor Dodd? Really? Councilor McManaman? Really? Councilor Gregg? Anything? Good. Okay. Probably going to let you guys do all the talking, so I won't go through anything. Disclosure of pecuniary interest and the general nature thereof. Not seeing any. So we're down to number five, confirmation of minutes.
Moved by myself, Councilor Gregg, seconded by Councilor Thomas, that the minutes of the regular council meeting held on November 14th, 2016, as printed, be adopted.
And all in favor? That is carried. 5B.
Moved by myself, Councilor Gregg, seconded by Councilor O'Leary, that the minutes of the public meeting held on November 14th, 2016, as printed, be adopted.
Thank you. All in favor? That is carried. Next, down to number six, which is the resolution.
Moved by myself, Councilor Gregg, seconded by Councilor Koepke, that City Council now go into committee of the whole to consider public meetings, deputations, public question period, matters arising from correspondence, reports, matters tabled, motions for which notice was previously given, and other business.
Thank you. All in favor? That's carried. So we're now in committee of the whole. At number seven, we have no public meetings, but at number eight, we do have a deputation tonight. Master Tag is here from the men's program to talk to us about the National Day of Remembrance and Action on Violence Against Women. So welcome. Guess get you to push that little button so the red light comes on and then we can hear you. There we go. Thank you.
Okay. This is my normal.
Yeah, you don't have to get right down to it as long as it's on. Yeah.
Okay. So thank you very much, Worship and Council, for inviting me and us. We have Megan Ellis here from Métis Nation, and we represent a committee that is organizing December 6th, National Day of Remembrance and Action on Violence Against Women. So we also want to recognize that we are on indigenous land of the Saugeen and Nawash people. So we're going to talk briefly about the National Day of Remembrance and Action on Violence Against Women. We will have a vigil at the Parkett place beside City Hall on December the 6th at noon. And it would be great if some of City Council would be represented there. So the established in 1991 by the Parliament of Canada, this day marks the 27th anniversary of the murders in 1989 of 14 young women at L'École Polytechnique de Montréal. They died because they were women who chose to study engineering, which at the time was very much, and still is, a male-dominated profession. As well as commemorating the 14 young women whose lives ended in an act of gender-biased violence that shocked all of Canada, December 6 also represents an opportunity for all of us Canadians to reflect on the phenomenon of violence against women in our society, including Indigenous women and the missing and murdered women. It is also an opportunity to consider all the women and girls for whom violence is a daily reality, and to remember those who have died or went missing as a result of gender-biased violence. And finally, it is a day on which communities can consider concrete actions to eliminate all forms of violence against women and girls. And some of the actions that we could think of, and there's a lot more, would be, for instance, to recognize violence against women and children, to recognize when it happens, speak up when you witness violence against women and children, resist sexist, misogynist, and racist language, learn about the root causes of violence in relationships and families, challenge politicians to recognize violence against women as a crucial issue to be resolved, talk with others, particularly with men, about violence against women and what we can do to make change, because it affects all of us. And what we really need to do is to raise our children with kindness and great care. Again, this event will take place at the City Hall Parquette on December the 6th at 12 noon. And before we will present the names and the pictures of the 14 women who were killed in 1989, we ask City Council to endorse this event, and that you will send somebody to represent, to be represented at this event. And we also ask you to consider actions to end violence, gender violence, against all women and children in Owen Sound. Okay, now Megan will. We will go through the pictures of all the 14 women. Many of us have never seen them. And Megan will say the names of the 14 women.
Sonia Pelletier. Anne-Marie LeMay. Michelle Richard, Anne Marie Edward, Maurice Leclerc, Maurice Lagagne, Annie Turcotte, Barbara Marie Klusenik, Barbara Daniel, Annie Saint Arnaud, Natalie Croutot, Helene Colgnon, Maud Havernick, and Genevieve Bergeron.
Thank you. Austin, go ahead.
Just a quick question, if I could. You mentioned it was going to be, the ceremony was going to be in the Parquette, City Hall Parquette. Is that the Percy England Parquette beside City Hall?
Yes.
Or where the temporary location of City Hall is? I just think people would like to know.
Yeah, very good. Thanks so much. It's between City Hall, the real City Hall, and community living. So it's on the right side of City Hall.
Thank you. That's December 6th, 12 p.m. Beside City Hall. Good. Thank
any,
you.
Any other questions?
Seeing none. I'm sure we'll get somebody there.
Thanks so much.
Oh, there is a question. Yeah.
Well, no, it's not a question. It's just a statement, because, Joachim, you know that my Zana Club will be there, because this is our 16 days of mourning for these women. And so our club is right now going through this. Zonta says no to violence against women. So our group will be there to mm-hmm. support this.
Very good. Thanks.
Good. Thank you. So next is number 9, public question period. Seeing nobody, moving to the microphone. Number 10, correspondence received. For which direction of council is received? I know there's one piece. Do you want to give us a sort of an overview of what it is?
Your Worship, this is a letter from Lieutenant Colonel Christian Lillington, commanding officer of the 4th Canadian Division Training Center in Meaford. Lieutenant Colonel Lillington wrote to express his gratitude for the support provided by the City of Owen Sound during the search for Private Andrew Fitzgerald in August of this year. Lieutenant Colonel Lillington recognized that the businesses, individual citizens and authorities, and the professionalism of the city's police force was instrumental to the search and played a role in sustaining the Fitzgerald family in their time of grief. He also identified that the closure the family received would not have been possible without the extraordinary, immediate, and selfless reaction of the citizens of Owen Sound. The full text of the letter is available in the agenda for tonight's meeting, posted online on the city's website.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to put that onto the agenda so that we could all hear it and hear the thanks to our citizens, to our police force, and everyone that reacted so quickly and worked so hard for that event. Councillor Koepke?
Your Worship, I would move that this correspondence be received.
Thank you. All in favor? That's carried. Thanks. So we're down to 11A, so reports from City Manager with regard to partnership with Grey County for Economic Development.
Thank you, Your Worship. This evening's report deals with the partnership with Grey County for Economic Development in 2017. The City has always looked to create partnerships that would benefit its taxpayers. Several times a year, Grey County's Chief Administrative Officer Kim Weingrove and I meet to discuss areas of mutual interest for the county and the city. The partnership that is proposed for 2017 between the county and the city will see the county with more human resources devoted to economic development and still have the city well represented as that occurs. The partnership will see the city's manager of economic development transition to Grey County's economic development team as of January 1st, 2017. The city will contribute financially to assist in that transition in 2017. I am confident that in 2017, with the assistance of county staff and the city's team approach to development, we will continue to see growth for Owen Sound. During 2017, one of City Council's priorities will be to focus on the city's economic development vision in 2018 and beyond. And again, tonight's report deals with a partnership with Grey County for Economic Development 2017. I might recommend, Your Worship, that Council approves myself communicating with the CAO for the county to make this transition possible, Your Worship.
Okay, so that would be the motion then, when it comes?
Yep.
Yes. Okay. Councillors? Councillor Lemon?
I would certainly move this motion. I think working together we can achieve a lot more than a bunch of individuals, and I would so move that be appointed to negotiate the transition as per our understanding from your report this evening.
Thank you. Councilor Koepke?
Just a brief comment, Your Worship. Economic development definitely is something that it affects the whole region and the whole county, and I think anything somewhere else certainly helps Owen Sound, and something in Owen Sound helps the other areas as well. So I think this is a good move.
Your Councillor Scott, Councillor Gregg.
I agree with the first couple comments. I just have a question. We have a couple pillars in our strategic plan that economic development reports to that committee with information. What's our plan moving forward on kind of backfilling that then? Some of the measurements and metrics and so forth that should be and would be provided.
Thank you. Through your worship, I'm actually working on the report on the strategic plan that will be before council in 2017, and Mr. Furness will be assisting me in that particular report. In the immediate future, my office will take a more active role in economic development, again, with a team approach from senior management. So, and Steve certainly, through this process, will be available to assist us at the county level. I think I should mention, your worship, Mr. Furness is with us tonight, and I certainly want to thank Steve, should council make this resolution. He's been a great asset to the city, and I'm sure he will take all of his knowledge of the city with him as he moves forward to the county, should that occur.
Thank you. Anything else for now?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Deputy Mayor Wright.
Thank you very much. I actually was going to say something when I gave my county report, but at the county on Tuesday, the county passed a motion to do this. And as a matter of fact, they're absolutely thrilled to have Steve come up to the county. I think it's a great move. They think it's a great move. And mind you, there was a little bit of skepticism, of course, because it's Owen Sound that's offering something to the county. But once we got over that hurdle and everyone saw the benefit of having somebody with Steve's experience up at the county to work with all of the county, because I know that it's been tough for Steve when he sees things that could happen that in other areas and knows that it's out of bounds because he's with the city. So this makes it very practical, and I think it will work very well for all of us. So the county is very happy to have Steve and very happy that the city has offered this.
I guess all I would say, Your Worship, is certainly this doesn't mean that Owen Sound is saying no to economic development or is in any way downplaying the importance of economic development in the city. And, you know, as we move forward, the Economic Development Committee will continue to meet, and I guess we'll reinvent things as we go. And I certainly fully expect that Steve is going to be in here like a dirty shirt whenever possible anyway. So I think that, you know, it's just important to get it out there that we're not in any way changing our approach to economic development at this point.
So from my point of view, when the county hired its new CAO, being Kim Wingrove, she had an awful lot of experience at the province with economic development. That was one of the big pluses. Since her arrival, they put together a very thorough plan up the county for economic development. We're all going after that same elusive person out there and trying to get them to our area. If somebody came and set up in Chatsworth or set up in the area, we're going to benefit one way or the other. Of course, there's certain things we want in Owen Sound, and we're better at some of those things than the rural communities. But there's great opportunities for all of us. As that plan has developed and the need for staff at the county has developed, they've made, I think, great decisions with adding of staff. Steve's got a million years of experience, knows his stuff, knows what's going on in the city, and I think it's a great opportunity for him and for absolutely everybody in the county. We'll have to look at if there's a niche that the county isn't filling that we need to fill in that. We need to figure that out, and we can look at that over the next year and figure it out. So we won't be giving up on economic development, but I think there's a better opportunity for us working with the county to move that ball forward. So Councillor Lemon moved the motion. Anyone else? All in favor? That is carried. Good. Number two, report from Director of Corporate Services, Internal Debenture, Mr. Ritchie, handling that.
I'll be taking that this evening, Your Worship. Tonight's report is the issue of an internal debenture for Harrison Park electrical upgrades and wastewater capital. In 2011, the City of Owen Sound began the project of upgrading the electrical system at Harrison Park. Phases 1 and 2 wrapped up in 2016 with a total cost of just about $777,000. There's quite a list of the work done, Your Worship, and it's quite extensive. I won't read them all. Phase 3 will replace the remaining overhead and underground primary and secondary supplies to the campground, pool, and other facilities in the park with underground services. This project is included in the 2017 capital budget and funded through current year revenues. In other words, it will not be debentured when it occurs, Your Worship. In addition, there is $650,000 of wastewater capital projects to be included in this debenture issue. The rate of interest is 3%. It is compared with the rate that we would receive for external funding sources, as confirmed through recent discussions with Royal Bank. The GBE reserve funds are the source of funding for this debenture, Your Worship. And with that, we look to issue an interim debenture for $1,426,941.
Mr. Riccio, maybe get you just to give a couple of sentences on what the GBE fund is. We know what it is, but there might be others that don't.
Certainly, Your Worship. Back in 2001, the city sold GB Energy Incorporated, our hydro company, to Ontario Hydro for $16,250,000. We have used that fund, I will say, since that time, at least twice completely for large. Certainly, everyone recall the big dig was very much financed using that money. Council has always returned that fund back through actually paying an internal debenture. Currently, approximately $11 million of that fund is financing the Regional Recreation Center, and we are paying that money back. And of the remaining roughly $5 million we need to invest, we will be investing $1.4 million in ourselves at 3%. So we're using proceeds from the electric utility sale to help finance other city projects.
So we've maintained and carried that $16 million all the way through. We borrow against it, repay it. It hasn't been spent or gone
away. That's correct, Your Worship.
Good, thank you. Others? Deputy Mayor Wright?
I'll save this question for corporate services.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Lemon?
The 3% interest, does that go back into the GBE fund, or does that come to the city as earned income?
What will happen to that money, Your Worship? It will go back into the GBE reserve, but the interest earned on that money every year is used to pay down the loan on the Regional Recreation Center. As you will recall, it's a long process. I'd have to look through. Certainly, Ms. Allen is more familiar with the current standing of that. I believe that payback is something in the neighborhood of 25 plus years. So it will be a long time getting that money back, but we knew that when we made that commitment, Your Worship.
Motion? Councillor Lemon?
I would move that we move ahead with the internal debenture from the GBE fund for Harrison Park electrical upgrades and the wastewater capital.
So moving the recommendation?
Yes.
Okay. Any other comments? All in favor? That's carried. Number three, manager of economic development adjustment to direction. The new scholarship fund for medical students.
Thank you, Worship. This is a report from Mr. Furness that is with respect to the funds for doctor recruitment. There was a report through corporate services earlier this year that established two funds through the community foundation, one a flow-through fund and an endowment fund, as well as certain funds held in the city reserve. In having worked with it this year and consulting with various users, the purpose of this report is really to seek approval to make a small adjustment to the fund. There would be an endowment fund with $56,000, and it would generate funds for physician recruitment activities and any, as well as provide scholarship funds, and then the flow-through fund. And the proposed adjustment is that we would merge the flow-through fund with the endowment fund. This would still allow there to be a scholarship as well. It would also allow flexibility in how the funds are used. There would also be the small amount of money retained by the city and used at council's discretion in terms of doctor recruitment and welcoming activities. So the recommendation, Your Worship, is that in consideration of the report, you would direct the mayor and clerk to sign a matching funds agreement and the following for the flow-through funds, $11,733, endowment fund at $56,785, and a current city reserve for recruitment.
Thank you. Councillor Koepke?
Thank you, Your Worship. I'm happy to move the recommendation, but I have a couple questions. And perhaps Mr. Furness would be the one that might need to answer these. With the flow-through funding, that increases the amount that will come out from the Community Foundation of this fund for scholarships. Is that correct?
Yes, what we're doing is taking the flow through and adding it to the endowment fund, and that's the part that gets matched. So okay. The Community Foundation would like to get, they have a new policy about not having flow through funds. So
right.
Part of that is meeting their objectives, but part of this is meeting an objective where we can get matching funding. And rather than set up a separate scholarship fund, we add it to the endowment fund, and it gives us flexibility how to use that dollars.
Would it be possible, I don't know if there's a committee that reviews these or not still, there's not a physician recruitment committee anymore, but I was wondering if there could be some thought put into perhaps a special scholarship for 2017 for Owen Sound's 160th, just a one-time thing for 2017. If
The way this is set up is you have that flexibility, and the Economic Development Committee was sort of took that over, that doctor recruitment, although I don't know that there's a lot to be discussed strategically, but that could be taken and that could be discussed, yes.
So it would go to Economic Development then, that idea?
It could.
Does it sound like it fits, or? I just thought because 2017 special, maybe we could throw something special out there and encouraging another student to go into physician or medical school.
Yeah. I think the overlying principle is that this money was all donated, and it's been kept, and it was donated to assist in physician recruitment. And part of, we've done this in the past through these funds, was to support, I think the way the criteria was set up is we had it with, if you graduated from an Owen Sound High School, or in medical school, not medicine, it had to be a family physician. So that could be set up, yeah.
So that would be a separate motion. I'm taking it for now. I'll move this motion and come back to that.
Okay, thank you. Any other discussion, questions? Seeing none, call the question. All in favor? And it's carried. So we'll go back to you, Councilor Kepke.
Okay, a second motion being that the Economic Development Committee consider a special scholarship award for Canada to celebrate Canada or Owen Sound's 160th as a one-time scholarship from this particular fund. Does it make sense?
Where is the money going?
To a student furthering their career in medical studies. Just a one-time.
I wonder if we could just say, as Mr. Furness pointed out, not just medical studies, but it's specifically for family physician studies.
Yes.
So I wonder if we can just add that.
Certainly, word. That's fine.
Deputy Mayor Wright?
And we had a committee at one point, and we gave out scholarships to students who were away at university studying to be a doctor, and hoping that we could draw some of them back, and we were in fact successful in drawing one of them that received $1,500 a year. Well, we had, I believe it was, we had so much money, and we divided it among all of those that applied. So how would we do this?
Well, and those funds were drawn down and were, you know, finished. This way, you could set it, I believe you could use the Community Foundation tools as well, but you'd have to talk to them. So this, it's just about the amount of money that you would have, and you could split it up depending on how much return you have, but you could set the criteria. And that's what the flexibility is about having this fund flow through to the endowment fund.
Okay. So economic development.
Yeah.
This motion is just to investigate it, so.
Okay. Other questions? Go ahead.
Could Councillor Kepke repeat the motion?
That the Economic Development Committee be requested to review the possibility of an Owen Sound 160 award for 2017 only to a student furthering their career in family physician, as a family physician. Thanks.
Okay, Thanks. Not seeing any other comments. Call the question. All in favor? That is carried. Down to number four, which is a verbal report from Deputy Mayor Wright.
Thank you very much. We had the County Council met on the 22nd of this month at our very last meeting for this year, and it was an interesting meeting. Gilbert Rice, who is a citizen of Owen Sound, was awarded a provincial honor, a very prestigious honor, in the Ontario Museum Volunteer of the Year Award. He has given 50 years of volunteerism to the community. He's done a number of things for the city. In fact, he was the one that restored the clock at the old fire hall that burned, the old city hall that burned down, and that it was Gilbert Rice that restored it. We would have liked Gilbert to come tonight so that we could honor him, but he said he graciously declined, saying he's been feted enough and he doesn't want any more. So I said, okay, we'll just mention it that he was given this wonderful award. And he's done a lot more, and there is, if anybody's interested, I have it all on the internet that I'd be willing to set it to. I am back on the Board of Health for another year, so if any of you have any health problems that I can take forward, that'd be fine. We had a joint meeting with Bruce County and this past week, and it was a very, very good meeting. As a matter of fact, I don't mind Richard said he was going to talk about this, but we did do a joint motion and calling for a moratorium on school closures, and that was very worthwhile. It all made the front page of the paper today, so that was good, and that's the end of my report. Oh, don't forget the inaugural is next Tuesday night. You're all welcome.
Any questions for Deputy Mayor Wright? Seeing none, thank you. We're down to 11B, which is the consent agenda.
Your Worship, on the consent agenda this evening, there's a report from the junior planner respecting Georgian Bluffs consent for 218-142 concession 3 RR3, file number B08-2016, notice of decision. There are planning notices from other municipalities where no report is triggered. There are minutes of boards and committees for receipt, being the Tom Thompson Art Gallery Board meeting on November 5th, Owen Sound Police Services Board meeting October 26th, Owen Sound Municipal Nonprofit Housing Corporation and Owen Sound Housing Company meeting October 18th, Grey Sauble Conservation Authority meeting October 12th. Lastly, there is correspondence received which is presented for the information of Council. A full listing appears at 11B8.
Good. Thank you. Greg?
Moved by myself, Councilor Gregg, that City Council hereby receives items 11B1 to 11B8 on the consent agenda dated November 28, 2016, and further that the recommendation contained in report 11B1 be approved.
Thank you. Any questions? Councilor McManaman?
Thank you, Worship. I did have a question about 11B1. For many years, as long as I've been here, we received many, many planning notices from the county and from our neighbors, and I'm quite sure other councils have thought, you know, a good majority of those are just sort of ones you look at, there's no comment, there's no reason to be concerned or look at them, and they're just run-of-the-mill, if I could call them that, and probably from time to time you wonder, why are we doing that? And the answer is 11B1 tonight. This notice tonight is for a lot severance from a farm to a residential lot, severing a piece off of the farm for residential lot right on the city limits. It doesn't meet the provincial policy statement. It's acknowledged there. It doesn't meet the county official plan. It's acknowledged there. And yet it's approved by our neighbors and by the county. I'm not going to say a whole lot more than that. People think we want to get along with our neighbors. We do want to get along with our neighbors. At some point, do our neighbors want to get along with us, is my question. Why this has been approved, I don't know. I can't explain it. It's not explained in the report at all. It admits in the county report that this doesn't meet their official plan. But at some point, you pick your battles and you move on. But I just couldn't let it past that sometimes it's noted that we comment or get involved in our neighbor's business. This is right here. Why? 11B1. So I think that's all I have to say. Sorry, I had a question for Ms. Coulter. In the county report, it says they ask that the severance be deferred until certain information comes forward on the fractured bedrock and how the environmental concerns, I guess, if you would. Has that, but, and yet, the very next notice is George Bluffs has approved it with no mention of they take into account those environmental concerns. Do you know anything more about that, or do we have any more information?
Through you, Your Worship, the county did request an environmental impact study looking at this whole issue of karst topography. There was a report prepared by GM Blue Plan with respect to the karst assessment for this property, and there were three recommendations that report made with respect to the application. And it did note that because of the limited overburden, that the sewage system design should include a raised bed to meet the requirements of the Ontario Building Code, and that the groundwater in the area be considered under the direct influence of surface water, and that disinfection, UV or chlorination be implemented as part of the domestic water supply system. So the county did ask for that, and I understand the study was completed.
Sorry, is that part of the recommendation from, that doesn't appear to be in the recommendation from the township?
Through Your Worship, looking at the conditions of the consent, there were four of them. The first condition is fairly general, and it just states that the owner enter into an agreement with the municipality of Georgian Bluffs, if necessary, to provide for any applicable development charges, parkland dedication, applicable permits, municipal servicing, or related development matters. So perhaps the conditions recommended would be included in that related development matters. However, I can't say that without question.
Okay, thank you. Anyway, I said enough. I did say the county didn't give a rationale. There is a rationale. The local municipal, they did not flag to the local municipal staff that they must meet the policy of the official plan. I didn't realize that was one of the criteria for turning down or allowing an application. Anyway, I'll leave it at that. It's just a frustrating exercise. That's all. Thank you, Your Worship.
Thank you. Others? Councilor Greg?
If I could just comment on that, and I do so understanding your legitimate concern with the development rate on our doorstep. I would just mention that in the past, there has been a tendency to worry a little too much about issues that aren't within 500 meters or within 1 kilometer. And it should be pointed out also that this particular one actually would, under all circumstances, come to Owen Sound to evaluate, because it's within the boundary that's legislated in the Planning Act that the neighboring municipality has. We go a step beyond still in our policy, and we request all these consent agenda planning notices, which may be on the east side of Meaford or the northwest side of Georgian Bluffs, that have no impact on us whatsoever. So I just want, you know, that's an important thing to point out. This particular one, under all normal, you know, circulations, would indeed come to Owen Sound. It's part of the Planning Act. It's right next door. It has to. Our current policy goes much further and creates a little extra work looking at the additional planning notices.
Councilor McManaman?
Sorry, I was going to let it go, but I'm not going to be able to after those comments. If someone could state the case and time that the city has commented on something that has not been a concern, legitimate concern, I'd like them to raise it. I don't recall it ever happening, not in my time anyway. The only time that the city has commented, I would suggest that this example which is 500 meters, what's contiguous with the city, is right on the city border, and it is being overlooked. They're overlooking the official plan, their own official plan, they're overlooking the provincial policy statement, and that is right on our border. Discussions we've had have been further than 500 meters, that is a correct statement, but they have been much, much, much larger in their scope. I think one was an 86-lot subdivision that didn't have any servicing. So I think this example shows why the city needs to be vigilant, why the city needs to continue to watch, because by all accounts, looking at this this file, no one else is. That's all. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to call the question, which was Councillor Gregg's motion with regard to the consent agenda items. All in favor? Okay, that's carried. I think at number three was a report from the Tom Thompson Art Gallery. Councillor Dodd, anything you want to update us on?
Thank you, Your Worship. Just a few quick things here. There was just a review of some fundraising capital campaign ideas since we approved the gallery to move forward with their incorporation process. They're looking into, there need to be potentially a revision in some one of their bylaws, one of the newly incorporated bylaws regarding the board governance policy. The way it was currently written didn't apply to how the board actually sits. Minor detail, doesn't affect what the end governance model is going to be. It was more about just in the bylaw, it didn't state exactly how the board was situated currently. Gallery's still looking for a January kind of incorporation charitable status goal, so that's moving forward. And the last thing I just wanted to say was this Thursday, December 1st, is the Chamber of Commerce Alive at 5, which is being held at the gallery, and it's the Chamber's Christmas party, so it's going to be held at the gallery this year.
Well, is there a fee for that this time?
I'm not sure. Okay. There might be because it's the Christmas party.
Any other questions for Councillor Dodd? Seeing none, thank you. Councillor O'Leary, I think, is next. Yes.
Thank you, Worship. These minutes are from the month of September. The ride program, we had 394 drivers checked, zero impaired driving charges. Traffic enforcement programs, there was a back-to-school speeding, aggressive driving, distracted driving, and parking violations in school zones. Speeding and heavy trucks using the 10th Street East extension between 9th Avenue East and 16th Avenue East. And distracted driving, failing to yield, this is the one everyone would be really interested in. Distracted driving, failing to yield for pedestrians, blocking intersections, and disobeying traffic lights on the 10th Street corridor between 4th Avenue East and 4th Avenue West. Criminal record searches, these searches are being completed and sent back to individuals within 3 weeks. And there were 837 people attend the front counter at the police service in the month of September.
Just want to clarify, Councillor O'Leary, the report says that it's dated October 26, 2016. You referred to it as being September. Is the October 26th date accurate then?
October 26th, no, that is, well, actually, no, those were statistics from September.
Okay, but the report was October 26th.
Correct.
Okay, good, thank you. Any other questions for Councillor O'Leary? Seeing none, thanks. Minutes from Owen Sound Municipal Nonprofit Housing and Owen Sound Housing Company Limited. Councillor Lemon.
We're continuing to move ahead with the development on the land we've acquired. We're in the process of, we have a very tight deadline early next year, so there will be more meetings to discuss the design and execution of it to allow us to build this accessible housing, which is badly needed in Owen Sound. There is a great shortage, and of the 700 plus names on the combined waiting lists for housing, there's a very large percentage which require a single bedroom unit. And there's a number of these, a large number of these with disabilities as being part of the rationale. And this housing we're building will be affordable housing. The rents will be less than the average market rent.
Thank you. So, Deputy Mayor Wright, anything you want to add to that? Any questions? I think, Councillor Lemon, since the last time you would have reported, if I'm not mistaken, some of us went up for a tour through the residential area, and it was quite impressive. I guess we should have done that the first month that we were sitting around here to understand it better, but it's very well kept, and it's amazing how people look after their units up there, so thank you.
Yeah, we were there in time to see some of the Halloween decorations that were out, and I thought they were fantastic. Time that the people spent with their children and family doing that. It was just wonderful.
Thank you. Councillor Koepke.
Thank you, Your Worship. Gray Selva Conservation Authority minutes for October 12th. In those minutes, the board reviewed new operation guidelines for the sale of wood products on all authority property regarding saw log harvests and small forest operations. And there were comments regarding the Niagara Escarpment Plan Review, and the Grace Alba Conservation Authority do not support the expansion of the NEC boundary at this time due to existing protections through other act statements and regulations, and they have requested full consultation with affected landowners and lower tier municipalities. At the same meeting, I don't think there's anything else of significant at that meeting, Your Worship. Thanks.
Thanks. Questions for Councillor Koepke? Seeing none. Thank you. So we're down to correspondence received, which I don't think there's anything in there, was there? Any councillors picking out anything? Okay, we're down to 11C, minutes of boards of committees for approval. First one is minutes of the Canada 150 on Sound 160 ad hoc. Back to Councillor Koepke.
Thank you, Worship. On November 22nd meeting, there were a few items dealt with on that agenda, one being the Canada 150 grant agreement. The city was extremely fortunate to receive a federal grant in the amount of $25,000 towards our Mwanjeding Festival Canadiana Owen Sound project, and Council is being requested to have the mayor and clerk sign a bylaw to authorize that agreement, and as well a celebration 2017 calendar sponsorship. We've also been fortunate in receiving exclusive sponsorship for the calendar by Coldwell Banker, so an agreement will be required to be signed in that regard as well.
Moving.
I will move the adoption of those minutes, Your Worship.
Councillor McManaman.
Thank you, Your Worship. And I would just highlight, I know it states it in the minutes, they talk about merchandise for the 2015, and I see the Councillor Koepke has said they should be cautious or limited, and I would just really echo that. In 2007, we perhaps went a little overboard on some of the merchandise and best intentions, but at the end of the day, somebody's paying that bill, so I just would be very cautious on any merchandise. And I know you mentioned that in the minutes, I would just wanted to highlight it. Thank you.
In fact, I think from 07, you'll probably find that some of us still have boxes of merchandise that we bought to try and put some cash back in to hang around our basements. So, can you call the question? All in favor of approval of those minutes? Thank you. That's carried. Number two is minutes of City Hall Accommodation Ad Hoc Committee. Councillor O'Leary.
Thank you, Your Worship. The manager of the farmers market, Tom Pink, is working with staff to develop a mutually agreeable plan at the rear parking area for market vendors and visitors. There's a furniture update. Congets Architects presented various furniture options for offices, workstations, and meeting rooms. Furniture options include some useful features: small tables that can be configured into a large meeting table, lift tables and chairs that can be vertically adjusted for standing workstations. Also available are L-shaped desks that can be elevated to standing heights. Staff has put together a furniture subcommittee who will bring recommendations back to the ad hoc committee. The construction drawings are about 90% complete. And Alara also did a costing review, and this is again back October 25th. He presented the costing review based on 60% working drawing estimate, and the construction costs were running slightly below budget. And with that, Your Worship, I'll move approval of those minutes.
Thank you. Any questions? Seeing none, all in favor? That is carried. Thank you. Minutes of Community Services held November 16th. Senator McManaman.
Thank you, Your Worship. Proposal was made at the start of the meeting to have a project, a part of the Truth and Reconciliation process. The actual project would be called Walking Towards Truth and Reconciliation in Naywash. It would be centered around Kelso Beach Park. Five different sites, I guess you'd call it a storytelling tour within a walking distance. It would involve signage and wayfinding signage, those QR codes that you can read through smartphones that would tell the stories of the five different sites, being First United Church, Mary Miller Park, two sites in Kelso Beach, Kelso Beach Park, and then two sites at 2245 and 2255 6th Avenue West, which are, I believe, native important sites to the Native community, if that's maybe the best way to say it. These sites will involve sculptures of some sort and audio stories in English, French, and Ojibwe. The city's ask for this is, first of all, to allow us to have those structures on our site, on our property, sorry. We'd be in responsible for installing wayfinding markers and hosting the information on our website. So this would all be part of a 2017, again, another part of the 2017 celebrations. So the committee endorsed this project and is asking council to do the same. Other items were discussed. We had a letter from Municipal Nonprofit Housing about considering asking the city to consider reviewing our parking policy that we have for our developments, how much parking is required for certain for developments. Their suggestion was that car spaces, parking spaces, could perhaps be replaced with scooter parking spaces. The city's zoning bylaw is established and regulates how many parking spaces you have to have based on your on the building that it's accommodating. So I guess you'd say there was two suggestions, or will be two suggestions made back to the Municipal Nonprofit Housing Board. One, that they could consider when the city's updating its zoning bylaw, I believe next year, that they can ask the city consider including scooter parking as a suggestion, or they could ask for a site specific on the new property they're looking to develop. Two important points, I think, is that their property doesn't have any restrictions as far as parking. It can within the current zoning bylaw, it has room for its parking. I know the committee was certainly encouraged the board to have additional parking for scooting, but for scooters, it wasn't explained why you would need less automobile parking, or why certainly residents change from time to time, and one that requires scooter parking, the next one might require automobile parking. And so anyway, it's a much bigger issue than just than it might seem. So the committee and endorsed a letter going back where we don't recommend a blanket amendment, and those two suggestions were given back to the housing board. Just a discussion on the OMB review that is taking place, an Ontario Municipal Board review that is taking place right now with the province. They're looking at the jurisdiction's powers, citizen participation, and everything to do with the OMB. So what it was suggested is that the committee and council members would submit individual comments, looking through these minutes, if they wish to submit individual comments, that might be the best way to go, and then committee, a further staff report would come back to the committee once some draft changes to the Ontario Municipal Board are suggested by the province. A small amendment to the agreement for the Eastside Snowmobile Club. They want to extend their trail, which now is on the compost property near 28th Avenue East, extending it slightly further before it, before on the compost property and extending it slightly to extend it to 28th Avenue East. So a very minor amendment. And Your Worship, that is just of those minutes, and I would move acceptance of them.
Questions, Councillor Lemon?
Yes, there's a slight misstatement there. I do not believe the zoning bylaw will be done for 3 or 4 years. I would ask Ms. Kolder if she could comment on that. The zoning will be done for next year.
The The official plan review is planned for 2018, and then the zoning review would follow that. So it won't be ready for a few years.
Right. So probably 2019, 2020, before it actually comes into play. And just to explain something, the reason for the request about parking is the housing we're developing is not your atypical subdivision, far from it. It's going to be fully accessible, and a large number of the people who will be living in the one-bedroom units, which will be on obviously the ground floor, and there'll be no upstairs to them, use scooters and electric wheelchairs. The problem with storing those those two pieces of equipment inside where people live is that sometimes the batteries malfunction, and it's a danger to their health and welfare because they've been known to explode and give off noxious gases, poisonous gases, actually.
Your Worship, if I might, I would echo Councilor Lemon. I think the committee was very much in favor of the Housing Board considering scooter parking as part of their development. The question was, why would it? You'd still need the traditional parking, if I can call it that.
Well, part of the reason of the people I know, and there are quite a few of them that use scooters, none of them have a car. So green space is more important than asphalt in some respects as to where you live. And we need enough parking, but we don't need excess parking. It just creates more water runoff, stormwater runoff, but also reduces the amount of green space. And the one thing you can turn green space into parking, it's very difficult to reverse that and change parking into green space if it's not needed. We're going to be having a report as a result of the accessibility committee meeting earlier today, and I've been in touch with housing on this as to the density, and we're trying to get some handle on percentage that would be excluded. We're still going to have parking for cars and lots of it. We're just saying, why would you expect and hold us to a higher standard than in other areas where it's 1.5 parking units? At the time when the bylaw we currently have was written, scooters were very rare. Now they're not. And the numbers are only going to increase, they're not going to decrease in the foreseeable future. The problem is that these scooters don't weather well sitting outside. So what we're trying to do is make it safer for the residents, make it convenient so they can recharge the batteries, which is important, and make sure that people can't vandalize the scooter or electric wheelchairs.
Ms. Coulter, has the Housing Board submitted plans yet?
Through you, Your Worship, we have done a pre-consultation with the Housing Board.
But we're having a conversation that is months in advance, I think, aren't we?
Exactly.
Councilor Kepke? Good. So I'm going to call the question on approval of the minutes of the community services from November 16, 2016. All in favor? That is carried. Thank you. Minutes of Economic Development Tourism Committee from November 18th.
Thanks, Your Worship. We had a report on our downtown revitalization project, which is well underway. At this point, 453 customer of origin surveys were completed in October, and that information is being collated now. The owner and landlord survey is in progress. 137 of the proposed 150 surveys have been completed there. And the good news is the resident survey will be launched in early 2017. It'll be available online, and the way it's worded here is that the purpose is to gather the opinions of the downtown by people who don't come downtown. And I think that the whole focus is to try and determine what we can do to make downtown more welcoming for people and bring more business down there. There will also be focus groups held during that time. We had a verbal report as well on the Bruce Power Supplier Day, which is an exciting initiative that the Manager of Economic Development, the City Manager, and all of staff, I guess, are really getting involved in. As we know, Bruce Power is ramping up for another great big billion-dollar build, refurbishment, and the focus this time from Bruce Power's perspective is to source as much as they can locally. So Owen Sound is busy positioning itself as a community nearby that could certainly host workers and businesses if it comes to that. And so we're very excited about the prospects for that initiative. The only other thing really that I wanted to bring to council's attention and maybe to the attention of the public who are watching our meeting tonight is a report we had from Marion Lugas, who's the principal of Georgian College here in Owen Sound. Now, the college is working hard to grow their international student program, and they have 20 power engineering technology students coming in January, and I believe they were coming from India and China. And what we're in need of now, the plea has gone out for student housing in Owen Sound for these international students who are coming here to visit. And if anyone has a room available for an international student, they can just contact Georgian College directly and ask for Marion Lugas, the principal of the college. She'll be very happy to hear from them. And with that, Your Worship, I will move acceptance of these minutes.
Any questions? Seeing none, all in favor? That is carried. Thank you. So the last one is revised minutes from Operation Committee meeting held on October 27th, 2016. Deputy Mayor Wright?
Well, thank you very much. These minutes have, we've already gone over these minutes. The changes that have been made are basically have to do with motions that have been rewritten in order to make the intent clearer for the future. So they did have to be ratified, and so they're back at council. So that nothing in has changed in what was reported earlier.
So you're moving
approval of the re-ratified minutes.
Okay. Any questions?
Approval of the
any questions? No. All in favor? That is carried. Good. Thank you. So we're down to other business, and in my last, we started with staff. Mr. Backing, you had one.
We have video taken just last week of the wastewater treatment plant. This is intended to give council a bit of an update as to the status of the project. Since we last spoke, you can see that the waterfront pathway has now been put in place, and the berm across the north side of the property has been regraded to its final grades. Not all of the landscaping has been installed as yet, but that will come next spring. So we're now facing westerly, moving along the east-west portion of the pathway towards the bay. The file too big? Okay. What you can see, some of the landscaping that has been done, and this is where ultimately the next connection of the waterfront trail will continue on across the development property to the north, which is the old Russell Brothers property. Here you can see the Métis lookout that was requested by the Métis group as part of their contribution to the project. The lookout itself has been constructed, save and except for the plaque, which is currently under under design and will be installed later on in the spring. Just seeing the roadway, the main roadway that comes down through the middle of the plant is connected to the trail, so that we have means to access the trail should that need arise for emergency purposes or whatever. We're now heading south along the Lakeshore Trail, and you can just see the digester off to the left of the picture. The digester has is back in operation. It's as Mr. Prentice would describe it, it's having mild indigestion right at the moment. By bringing the sludge back in from the storage tanks, it's quite caustic and we have to buffer it. And so it's not producing methane to the extent that we wish, but it will in due course once we get the indigestion sorted out. So that will happen shortly. Here you can see this is the new tank that was installed. This is the termination of the trail at the parking lot, the north parking lot for the Bayshore. Yeah, you can see the boat launch there.
Mr. Becking, Mr. Thomas is very glad that we have the Economic Development Committee, that you're showing why we need broadband and on sound.
I couldn't say more, Your Worship. Your point's well taken.
I'm assuming that was done
before. It was, yes. We can't fly that low in a fixed-wing aircraft.
Not legally.
Not legally, no. That's quite correct. Okay, and the drone will now take one more pass up basically the middle of the site. Between the road and the pathway will be landscaped as part of this contract for the full frontage of the plant. That work will happen next spring as we do the final cleanup. You can start to see the exterior masonry has been installed on this face of the administration building in the BAF. The blue is the sealant that's up against the poured concrete, and that masonry now is moving its way up the face of the building. Last week we would estimate that we were about 30 to 40% of the exterior masonry on the face of the building. And the contractor continues to make good progress in terms of getting the masonry work done. They'll finish off the exterior facade and then move to the inside to finish off any of the interior masonry that has to be done. You can see that the one of the subcontractors is putting on the roof. The work has, again, as of last Thursday when this video was shot, was nearing completion, and it has since almost been completed, save and except for the rain delays that we've experienced. I can say that so far the roof doesn't leak, which is a good thing. I think, Madam Clerk, we can cut it at that. There's not very much more. If there are any questions, Your Worship, I'd be happy to answer.
questions for anyone? Seeing none. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Worship.
Next, my list is I've got. Well, there is a question.
I just wonder. I'm not sure we actually rescinded. If we went back one step, the operations minutes when we were discussing the revision. Not sure we actually rescinded and then accepted the revised minutes. I just wondered if maybe the clerks could clarify that. My colleague here, Mr. McManaman, Councillor McManaman, just had me rewrite a revised motion in case we did not.
It was my understanding from Deputy Mayor Wright that their intent was to rescind the other motion and to affirm the revised minutes.
We did that at committee. Rescinded the at committee and brought it, and then we brought the revised minutes to the council.
Okay. Works for everybody? Good. Thank you. Councilor, sorry, you just got demoted to Mr. Alan Parker.
Thank you, Your Worship, members of council. I had two quick items. Councillor Thomas stole one of those, talking about Georgian College and visiting international students, so we don't need to talk about that. The only other one is a small administrative matter that, as approved by the city manager, the streaming of council meetings and certain other meetings on our website will be sort of held back for the next foreseeable future. We will certainly be recording everything and posting it on YouTube, but for the two people that actually do watch it as it is streamed on our webpage, we don't feel that that's going to be a big impact on the system at the moment. We did explore certain options, including having Rogers streamed through our page, but because we're actually doing the work anyway, that would necessitate actually purchasing a Rogers account, which would cost us more money to do what we're already doing for the audience of two people. Whereas when we do actually upload it to YouTube the following day, we have hits of in upwards of 30 to 140 people that watch it the following day. So we feel that this is an optimal decision for getting it out and communicating what is accomplished here at council.
So, thank you. Questions? Councilor Dodd?
Thank you, Worship. I know there's those possibilities when we're doing those streaming to see how many viewers are actually using that service. Okay. Is that actually what we've on an average we'll have two people that are streaming it on a council night?
Generally two. I think it hit a high of six, I think, at one point in time.
And is that one Sean over in the corner? Like, because if that's exactly, and I'm glad someone brought this up to do that, because if there really is two people that are using the service, and I know we are using Sean's time over here to do that yourself, so if that's something that no one's using the service, then if we can, if that's going to be doubled by the following year, then that's a great idea. So.
There's two parts of that. Certainly, we'll still be doing what we're doing now and recording it, and so it is uploadable tomorrow, and the clerks can reference it as they do quite often. But the streaming of it just on our webpage won't be available at this point in time at night.
Right. So is that going to save some staff hours then?
Not much. No, not really.
And again, there'll be a full report coming back to council in January on this, I believe. But we believe it should, yes.
Mr. Alan Parker, I can tell you that I know one of the people that will be disappointed we're taking it off, because now when I get home, I'm going to tell her all about it. So if she doesn't have that, I've already watched it. Oh, it's okay. So
well, there's the two. That's
the two people are spouses of councillors. Councillor Lemon.
Question, is this because of our current location, or is that with the same apply at City Hall?
Yeah, we've had the same number of hits across, going back, I looked over the past year, and it's low during whenever we stream it. The following day, it's quite high. So it's, is when we post it. And I guess more people have time to actually go and watch it during the day. It has nothing to do with our location, no.
Oh, okay, absolutely. Just one. I didn't know whether it was where we are.
Good.
Yeah, that's true. Monday Night Football. Well, I'm not going to touch that.
Thank you very much.
council. Councillor Lemon.
Yes, Your Worship. One of the things I noticed driving along 10th Street is a number of the starbursts aren't there. There's some that are missing that were up there last year. They're poles with nothing on them, and I was wondering if there was a reason for this, or does anybody know? Because I haven't got a clue.
Your Worship, there is a time limitation for the use of starbursts. I believe it's 6 months, and then they're required to be taken down.
Yeah. These ones were the ones that we've been putting up every year on the poles, light poles.
Councillor Koepke may have the answer.
I could probably help a wee bit. He's talking about the Festival of Northern Lights displays, starbursts that are on the poles.
The signs that I'm referring to, Your Worship, are a circular sign that says new. We call them starbursts as well.
And I believe that they are not all up because they weren't repaired. They could only repair so many, so they put up what they could.
Okay. I'm sorry, I was confused.
Next, Councillor Koepke, you've got three items.
Thank you, Your Worship. It was an honor to attend on behalf of the Mayor and members of Council the Peace Medallion presentation from the YMCA. And congratulations go out to Shirley John, the winner of the 2016 YMCA Peace Medallion, for her participation, empathy, advocacy, community, and empowerment towards peacemaking work in her community. So it was very honoring to be there, and Shirley was certainly very humbled to get this award. My second bit of information is regarding the Mill Dam, and those of us who are on the Conservation Authority Committee for the city received an email saying that this Wednesday they'll be starting to open the gates, letting the mill pond down for the winter. And the fish way will be temporarily closed until the pond is down and they can set for the flow operation. So just to let people know that. My third item is Giving Tuesday, which is happening tomorrow, November 29th. And this is a movement by Community Foundation Grey Bruce to create an international day of giving at the beginning of Christmas and the holiday season. So remember those in need and remember your favorite charity and giving, and I think I will choose to give a Christmas tree from the Kiwanis Club to a needy family. Thanks.
Thank you. Councillor O'Leary.
Thank you, Your Worship. Just wanted to comment on the Festival of Northern Lights when they changed the date for the opening night. It kind of changed things for Moonlight Madness. I haven't got the full report because we haven't had a DIA meeting yet, but from the people I talked to, Moonlight Madness was a success without the opening of Festival of Northern Lights. And Saturday night was turned out great. There's a lot of people, and I just want to congratulate the festival for a job well done. We had a lot of fun. Councillors and mayor were there, lots of staff, and it was a good night. Fun to have by all. The second one was wanted to wish Councillor Koepke a happy 49th birthday today. And did I have that wrong?
You're older than the rest of us.
Sorry about that. And the third one, we had a police board meeting last Wednesday, and Chief Sornberger was extremely disappointed that he was not put on the committee for the OPP costing. Said he has checked with other municipalities that were going through an OPP costing that had their chief on the committee. So I said I'd be glad to bring it to council. We'll let council decide. So I will put a motion on the floor that we would add Chief Sornberger to the OPP costing committee and open it up for discussion.
Okay. Councillor Dodd.
Thank you, Your Worship. Just a couple quick things here. Maybe through you to the city manager. Do you have any information on some of the past working groups for other municipalities? Is it common for the local police chief to sit on that working group?
Thank you. Through Your Worship, I have done a little work on this in the last few days. So I looked at five municipalities who have or are currently undergoing OPP costing.
In three of these, the chief of police or his designate was a resource to the committee or working group. So in three of the five, they were. In two, they were not. And in both of those instances, they outsourced, I'm going to say, the legwork of that, doing the financial analysis as well as the police comparative analysis. And that's what the city is doing. The one that I've actually used probably as our backdrop is Innisfil, Bradford, West Gwillimbury. They use Leavac Management Consulting Group, the one that council has allowed me to negotiate a contract with. I should point out that prior to my report at the last council meeting, I did discuss Leavac Management as an unbiased provider or analysis with both the OPP and the City of Owen Sound Police, and both confirmed they felt Leavac would provide unbiased analysis of both the financial and the police comparison. So certainly my attempt through this process, Your Worship, was to make sure that the analysis would be unbiased, and both of, I'll say, the proponents felt that Leavac would provide that to us. So three out of five did. The two who didn't used outside consultants to provide that service.
Thank you. I'll just say this right off the hop here. I have the utmost amount of respect for the police chief, or the chief of police here in Owen Sound. I think Chief Sornberger, a fantastic man for what he does, both in his profession and outside of what his regular duties are. My only concern on this working group is we already have appointed both Mayor Boddy and Councillor O'Leary as being police board representatives, first of all. So I don't really see the necessity to have the police chief sit on the working group of the local force when that's when we're doing a costing comparison. We've talked about how we want to have this open, transparent working group that had no conclusions made, and I just find it very challenging to think that our current chief of police on a local force, which is getting a comparison cost comparison to OPP, which may be a different service that we go, would be able to take off that police chief hat and be a voting member on the working group. I think absolutely he needs to be a resource for that whole process. I think 100% he does. But my only concern when we start getting involved in, okay, so Chief Sornberger sits on in this working group, do we have to contact the OPP and have a representative from them? I guess that's my only concern, is where do you draw the line of who the actual, we've got city staff, senior management, we've got two representatives from the police board on it, who are going to carry themselves and carry that in an unbiased way. That's my only concern and confusion is, yes, if we do put the chief of police on our local force, does that working group stay as an unbiased working group? That's my only concern about it. I'm fully in support of what our current working group is, and so I would not vote in favor of the recommendation brought on by Councillor O'Leary.
Any other comments, Councillor Lemon?
Well, I will not support the motion by Councillor O'Leary. I think we're walking into a real conflict of interest by definition, which is pecuniary interest. I do not feel that, I feel the chief does a good job, but I think this is an area where it should be totally transparent and without influence of either side. I hadn't thought of the aspect of then we should appoint somebody from the OPP, but yeah, we do that, and then we're going to have a committee of 75 experts, which means we won't get anything, and I think we just leave the way it is, and that's the way to work it. I don't believe the chief should be there because, I mean, it's the future of the police force, yes, but it's also the future of the city, and that's our responsibility.
Others? Any other comments? Just my only comment is, and I guess it's a question perhaps for Councillor Lemon, is it a pecuniary interest when it's not an advisory committee, but we're not going to be giving advice as such to council?
I am not an expert on the law, far from it, but I would, not only must you be not pecuniary interest, but you must not be perceived to be. And the perception would certainly, if I was John Q. Public, would certainly look at it that way.
Thank you. Councilor Koepke.
Thank you, Worship. I understand the committee to be analyzing the information they have received and bringing that information back to council. So the pecuniary interest is a financial gain or loss in the results of that analysis. So it's after the decisions are made that it's a pecuniary interest, not particularly immediately, but I do think we need to trust the consultant that we've hired for the non-biased opinion that they'll be giving.
Thank you. Others? Anyone? Deputy Mayor Wright.
Thank you very much. I am assuming that both sides, OPP and our own police, are available for as resource. I mean, our consultant must be in touch with these people on a regular basis. They'll be kept posted on what's happening.
Certainly, Your Worship. As they probe the OPP's proposal, they will obviously have to bounce that off of our current service. So I am certain they will be in contact with both groups.
Right.
Anyone else? Councilor McManaman?
Well, just for the record, I'm not going to be supporting the motion. I agree with Councilor Dodd and Councilor Lemon. I think we've set the committee and we should move forward with that.
Call the question. All in favor of Councilor O'Leary's motion? One. Opposed? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. So that's defeated. That was all three items. Thank you. Deputy Mayor Wright, we have
one item, and that was I was up at Georgian College today representing the mayor at the reopening of their fitness center. And this is quite a fitness center up there now. It's has been totally reconstructed in the basement. It was money used from the students who had raised the money and who put the motion on the floor that their money go towards this fitness center. It is going to be a facility that's open to the public by membership, and I just think it's great to have that at the college.
Thank you. Councillor Thomas, you had two, whatever order.
Is Your Worship, by now, certainly council will be aware that the Union Public Library Board last Thursday night regretfully accepted Meaford's withdrawal from its service contract halfway through. I just wanted to let council know that Mayor Al Barfoot joined us for that meeting, as did Mayor Bob Pringle. And certainly the union stands together in terms of what its position is. And its position is that nothing could be fairer than everybody paying the same price for library service. That is the basic principle on which the union stands. And we remain committed to that idea. There are a couple of other outstanding issues. I've heard a lot from the East about data collected by the library, and I just wanted to address that briefly. Certainly, Meaford is privy to all of the data that is provided to other union partners on an annual basis about the number of users of the library, and that will continue. That has always been such, and in fact, the CAO of Meaford has always been, under the current agreement, able to come and examine our data at the library if there's any questions about its accuracy or anything else. That said, we did suggest to the municipality of Meaford, I'm sorry, to the Meaford Public Library Board, that we would in fact consider their request for an even deeper look at the data if they would provide us with contract language that our solicitor would agree was legal under Ontario's privacy law, because we do have a concern. The Ontario Library Association recommends that libraries do not collect data to the depth that we're being asked to provide, and I'm quite comfortable with the Ontario Library Association position. That said, I've had lots of emails and telephone calls over the weekend from members of the former Sydenham Township of the library expressing concern and dismay over the potential loss of their library service. And we did reaffirm in our media release last week that we remain prepared to negotiate a two-year agreement at a fixed rate as requested by Meaford, and opening up the data provided they could provide us with that contract language. So that's where things stand as of today. Signs have gone up around the library letting Sydenham residents know that as of December 12th they'll be unable to borrow materials from our library, and that as of December 31st their card carrying privileges will be revoked, though as always anyone is welcome to come to our library and to use its facilities. And I'm happy to answer any questions if anyone in council has any.
Councilor Lemon.
On the same, and this is no reflection on you, Councilor, but this agreement's been around for a long time. It was worked out by a group of people who cared about the library and its important access. And it was my understanding when the municipal boundaries were redefined that there was a guarantee given to the residents of Meaford that in perpetuity they would have access to the Olmstown Public Library under the agreement. And this appears to have fallen by the wayside. I am very, very disappointed, as everyone is, and I'm hoping that people in Sydenham will speak their minds, and as the residents of Owen Sound do, and hopefully maybe some sober second thoughts will take come to pass that we may get some kind of a working arrangement.
Thank you. Councilor McManaman.
Thank you, Your Worship. And I'm glad Councilor Thomas kind of went over some of those facts, because I was involved in the renegotiation 5 years ago, and it was a huge point for the neighbors, Georgian Bluffs, Chatsworth, and Meaford, about data collection and how can they verify if the Olmstown Union Library says there's 500 members from Chatsworth, how do they know there's 500 members from Chatsworth? And there was a lot of discussion at that time, well, prior to that too, but also at that time, about, so how do we verify that, keeping in mind there are legal concerns as far as sharing data, confidential data. And it was agreed to at that time, and Francis Richardson was there as their representative. They also had Deborah Young was there as well. It was agreed to that the CAOs of any given municipality could come and verify that, come and look at the data, look, see it all, verify it, and everybody, you know, left the table shaking hands, saying that seemed like a fair resolution to, you know, if they have a concern, come and look at it. So I this issue about you have sort of reaffirmed what I thought was taking place or could take place. I'm not sure actually if George Bluffs and Meaford ever have in the last 5 years looked at the data, but certainly they're open to tomorrow if they wanted to. At last time we discussed this, I hoped that people would work together in partnership. I urge Meaford Council, I think it directly goes to their elected representatives, I urge them to get involved in this discussion. There's a month left to keep a union agreement that has worked well for a generation, if not longer. Certainly this agreement has been in place for a generation, but even further than that for some of the other townships. I urge them to get directly involved in this discussion. As you said, I don't quite understand. Everybody pays the exact same amount. So if you live in Owen Sound, you live in Chatsworth, you live in Meaford, you live in Georgian Bluffs, library service costs this much money. You have representatives on the board. If you think that, you know, there's something that's being spent unwisely, that's what the board's there for, and that's what your representative there for to speak to. So I urge them to get involved and stop this before it goes too far.
Any other questions? Councilor Thomas, I have a couple of questions. The building itself, all the upkeep, the capital of the building, how's that cost split up?
There is a very small capital component that our union partners and contract municipality pay of $3,000 per year towards the capital costs.
And the rest is carried by the city.
The rest is carried by the city.
And it's our building. Then the operational costs are divided up how?
The operational costs are divided up based on the number of card-carrying members each municipality has. And I could express it pretty simply, over time, it's been about 60% Owen Sound, 20% Georgian Bluffs, 10% Chatsworth, 10% Meaford in terms of users. And it fluctuates up and down depending on time of year. Many people don't understand that they do have to renew their library cards. So if you haven't been to the library this year, your card may be out of date, and I encourage you to come in and renew it. But that does account for some fluctuation in the figures.
So basically then the operation cost is split 60, 20, 10, 10.
Exactly.
Okay, got it. I wasn't sure that I understood it. Any other questions? Councillor Koepke?
Are there other ways of renewing your card as opposed to going into the library?
Well, that's a great question, and I really couldn't tell you.
I renew mine online.
Do you? Well, then you knew the answer to that. There we are.
Tricky. Others? Good. Thank you. You had another.
I have one other item, it's been a while since I've talked about this one, so I'm happy to be bringing it up yet again, now that there's a bit of positive action happening. Many of us will have read last week that Bruce and Gray County Councils held a joint meeting and passed a motion to fight rural school closures, and I brought a motion forward here tonight that I hope Council will consider passing, and it reflects the spirit, in fact almost the identical wording of the motion that was passed last week by Bruce and Gray Counties, and with your permission, Your Worship, I'll just read the motion.
Sure.
Whereas rural schools are integral to the future of rural communities, and whereas the Council of the City of Owen Sound agrees with the counties of Bruce and Gray and is deeply concerned that the current process to consider rural school closures is not inclusive and the timelines do not provide for adequate community input, and whereas it's critical that continued student achievement and well-being form part of reviews of schools, be it resolved that the Council of the City of Owen Sound urges the Minister of Education to rewrite the Pupil Accommodation Review Guideline to take into consideration community and economic value considerations of rural communities and provide for a more democratic process, and that until such time as the PARG is rewritten, that the province place a moratorium on any more rural school closures, and that this resolution be forwarded to the Premier, Minister of Education, and MPP Bill Walker. Now, if that seems familiar to some councils, it sounds just a lot like the presentation we made to the Minister of Education at AMO last year, and certainly our voices were heard there, but I think that there's strength in numbers, and it is certainly worth this council standing with Gray and Bruce Counties in pushing this issue forward.
I can maybe speak to it of what we did at the combined Gray and Bruce. Bruce County is reviewing the Watson and Associates. We all know who they are. They did a demographic review a couple of years ago, or prediction, whatever, forecasting of this area and where students are going to be. We've had a change at Bruce Power with growth coming for the next 30 plus years and potential students coming in. That Bruce County believes is a change that is going to affect what that Watson report would say, and that in fact the Blue Water School Board is not relying on an updated accurate report. Last week there was a rally at Queen's Park. There was something like 50 different groups that cover 800 different people that have signed a petition that's going across the province. We thought at Bruce County and Gray County combined, considering that it is both counties that cover the Blue Water District School Board, the same area, that it would make sense for us to do this. Sent it out to other counties and rural counties and regions, regional municipalities, as well as lower tiers being us. We could pass this and support it going and see if we can create some momentum. There was a bit of a rush to bring it on tonight because the legislature sits until December 8th, I believe, was the date, so it would be nice to get it to them before they sit. They're not back till February, which means any decisions the local school boards make for March 2017 will be long gone unless there's a change. So there's momentum going across the country that we're trying to support. Go ahead.
The Board of Health is weighing in on this as well. Dr. Kennedy right now is trying to gather all of the pertinent facts. The school closing in a small municipality where it's the only school, it's the hours of travel on school buses for small children. It's the taking away the livelihood of families as the content that we know it, the health and wellness of a family when their children are away, and there's such a thing as babysitters that are away cannot babysit. It's just a turmoil for a home that has not got a school in the community. So the Board of Health has weighed in now that we will be contacting the Minister of Health. Unfortunately, because of the closing of the legislature on the 8th, this is not going to happen until January, but the motions will go out to all boards of health in the province of Ontario, as well as to the Parent Association and the Minister of Health. So there's a real push on this.
Councillor Lemon?
You mentioned Bruce Power, but also Chapman Ice Cream weighed in this as well, and other businesses. And I really feel that the move by Greater Bruce County was most appropriate. And I'm really glad to see that there's going to be some pressure brought, because what goes on in the schools affects our community and the people within our community and that social health. Someone said to me that some kids spend more time in the school bus than they do with their parents, because it's, I've forgotten, an hour and a half each way. That's 3 hours a day, 5 days a week. That's 15 hours of time in the school bus. Ridiculous.
Others? No, going to call the question. All in favor? That is carried unanimously. Thank you. I don't really have anything. So number 13 is motion.
Moved by myself, Councillor Gregg, that the committee rise and report.
All in favor? That is carried. Resolution adopting proceedings, committee of the whole.
Moved by myself, Councillor Gregg, seconded by Councillor Koepke, that the action taken in committee of the whole in considering public meetings, deputations, public question period, matters arising from correspondence, reports, matters tabled, motions for which notice was previously given, and other business be confirmed by this council.
All in favor? That is carried. Notice of motions, seeing none, no of none. No new business arising by resolution, bylaws.
Through your worship, the bylaws listed for approval this evening include the confirmatory bylaw, a bylaw to provide for the services of the Owen Sound Fire and Emergency Services, a bylaw to amend the complaints processes policy, a bylaw to execute a grant agreement with the Minister of Canadian Heritage respecting the Festival Canadiana project, a bylaw to execute a sponsorship agreement with Lifestyles Realty Limited, Coldwell Banker, for the Celebration 2017 calendar, a bylaw to execute an assignment of lease agreement between Paul Vermillier, Nancy Vermillier, and Mahar Hussein for the Market Chip Wagon, and three bylaws to execute a certificate of final acceptance and assumption of works and facilities for Green Earth Subdivision, Sheldon Place 2, and Westview Heights Phase 2.
Thank you. Any questions? Seeing none, go ahead, Councillor Gregg.
Moved by myself, Councillor Gregg, seconded by Deputy Mayor Wright, that bylaw numbers 2016, 163, 164, 165, 166, 167, 168, 169, 170, and 2016, 171 be passed and enacted.
All in favor? That is carried. That completes our business for tonight. It is 8:43. We are adjourned. Thanks, everybody.